Okay, then we pass to the next speaker, who is Professor Paolo Criminelli. We'll talk about dark energy and gravitational wave observations.
Okay, so it's great to talk after the data, and the idea is to say in which ways these data constrain models of dark energy. It's based on a set of papers in the last few years with Filippo Vernizzi, Matt Lewandowski, Giovanni Tambalo, and Vicerit Incharuanara. So we just heard about the experimental data. So the observational gravitational waves started more than 5 years ago. And besides learning a lot about astrophysics, we, as we already discussed, we are learning something about fundamental gravity. In particular, this was already mentioned, we learned that the speed of gravitational waves is very close to the speed of light. So in this plot, there is the LIGO-Virgo observations, so the chirping up of the gravitational wave curve. And in the upper panel, there is the observation in gamma rays. And we see that the difference between the gravitational wave signal and the electromagnetic signal is of order seconds, which is probably related to the astrophysics of the event. But compared to the huge distance of order 40 megaparsec, gives a very nice bound. So the speed of gravitational waves is very, 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 very similar to the speed of light. So this was learned by this single event in 2017. Now, okay, this is not the only piece of the story, but so let me tell you what is the general philosophy, is that if dark energy exists, or better, if dark energy is not as simple as a cosmological constant, then it acts in general. Now I will specify to a certain set of models, but in general, it is a Lorentz violating medium. So it's something which so gravitational waves propagate in this Lorentz violating medium. So the general idea I want to discuss is that these observations can be seen as tests of what dark energy is, in the same way as when light propagates through a material will tell me something about the material itself. For instance, we will see that gravitational waves may have a different speed compared to the speed of light. It can have dispersion, as it was discussed already in the previous talk. Gravitational waves can be absorbed by the dark energy medium, and so on and so forth. Okay? So this is a general thing and that I will describe in a particular set of theories. But this, I think it can be generalized, and it's interesting. So, of course, I have nothing to say about the cosmological constant. In a sense, I'm afraid that none of the theories I'm going to describe are better than the CC at the level of tuning. So I see these tests as a test of our understanding of gravity. So I don't have anything to defend these theories. So let me go back to the observation. So we said that the speed of gravitational wave is constrained to be very close to the speed of light, up to corrections of order 10 to minus 15, which is basically the ratio between a few seconds and 40 megaparsec. And let me make two points, which will become relevant later, that we are doing observations at LIGO frequencies, which are of order, in wavelength, are of order, say, 10,000 kilometers. Now, why this is important? Well, it's important because I want to use these theories to constrain theories of dark energy. And of course, we're talking about very different scales. And this is something that we have to remember. So we're doing experiments at LIGO in electron volts at 10 to minus 13 electron volts. But of course, if we compare this with cosmological data has something to do about the Hubble scale, which is much, much lower. Okay, so it's something to take into account. Of course, in the future, we'll have experiments in LISA and maybe with larger black holes, and therefore this energy would be lower. Another point to make is that we're doing these experiments over cosmological distances. So this particular event is at a distance of around 40 megaparsec. I'm saying this because as we know, in local environments, dark energy may be screened. So there is the Weinstein effect in play or some other screening mechanism. But if we talk about distances of order 40 megaparsec, most likely the screening effects can be neglected or at least are not active all along the trajectory of the gravitational wave. Okay, so let me now focus on particular theories. So this is a choice, and we already heard some theories which do not belong to this class. So it's just a choice of something simple. So I don't have time to go through all the details, but I'm sure most of the audience is familiar. I'm talking about the effective field theory of dark energy. And the idea is simply stated is to choose the symmetry breaking pattern that dark energy has. So in particular, we're going to choose a very simple pattern in which dark energy chooses a preferred slicing of space-time in the same way as a scalar which is evolving in time would give. So in order to write down the most generic action compatible with the symmetries, I'm going to write down all possible geometrical objects which are invariant under the spatial diffeomorphism, but on the other hand, the time diffeomorphisms are broken. Therefore, I'm allowed to write objects like the extrinsic curvature of these surfaces, like the Ricci scalar of these surfaces, and so on and so forth. Okay. So it's a choice, and there are other symmetry breaking patterns. So this is probably the simplest. I'm also making another assumption, which is the fact that there is a common metric which couples to dark matter and the standard model. This is also an assumption that one could give up, but I'm also assuming this. So in this setup, I'm also now doing another assumption, which I focus on theories which do not propagate an additional degree of freedom. So theories without a ghost or an additional degree of freedom. So which are the we already discussed in this conference, that either Ordensky theories or beyond Ordensky. I'm going to comment a bit if I have time about those and other theories. So in the language I'm using, I can write these theories using these Lagrangian. So it's a bit uninspiring, but let me comment. So for instance, so the way I write the Lagrangian in this fashion, the advantage of this formalism is that you see immediately perturbations. In a sense, the operators until this one, so all these operators are at most, so they are quadratic in perturbations or even lower. So they affect perturbations around FRW. These operators on the other hand, they are cubic or higher order. So these are all important if we want to discuss, for instance, screening or nonlinear solutions. If you focus about linear perturbation theory, these are all the parameters that I will care about. So in this language, one can write theories like quintessence, Brans-Dickey. One can put a speed of propagation of dark energy perturbations, which is different from the speed of light using this operator, like k-essence theories. One can describe DGP, can describe what is called braiding, and can also describe in general what theories like Galilean, Ordensky theories, and beyond Ordensky. And within these formulas, one can also discuss about the DOST and so on, but I will concentrate on beyond Ordensky for the time being. In particular, in this language, Hordansky, which I remind you means that the equations of motion are of second order, has these equalities. So this operator is the same as this operator, and also this operator is the same as this operator. While beyond Hordansky, does not propagate additional degrees of freedom, although the equations of motion may contain higher derivatives. And in this case, these constraints are not present. Now, so let me go back to gravitational waves. So since this theory in general breaks Lorentz invariance spontaneously, as any fluid in the universe, in general, I expect that gravitational waves will have a speed which is different from the speed of light. And indeed, it's easy to see that if I look at this particular operator, so this K2 is given here below, this operator is the extrinsic curvature squared. So the extrinsic curvature contains the terms gamma dot, and gamma dot squared, of course, changes the speed of propagation of gamma, which is the graviton. So the constraint that I just discussed gives a very tight constraint on this operator. Okay, but not only that, because of course the gravitational waves that come to us propagates not in an exact FRW universe, but goes through the perturbations that of course exist in the universe, which are small but not negligible. So this means that the observation, LIGO-Virgo observation, put severe constraints on many of these parameters. Okay, and let me be more quantitative. For instance, let's look at one of these operators. We are interested. Of course, this operator can be arbitrarily small, but the most interesting regime is the regime in which this parameter affects gravity on large scales, so that potentially in the future we could observe its effect in, say, large scale structure observations or any cosmological probe. So, for instance, this is written in terms of these dimensionless parameters, okay? And say in the future we're going to test these parameters to be, say, of order 10%, 1%, because this is the typical modification of gravity that you get on large scales. So you see that the regime of interest of these parameters is when this is not so small. But the observation of gravitational waves tells me that on the other end, these operators, these dimensional ratios, are extremely small, of order 10 to minus 15. So when I put these bars, these are not really zero, but gravitational waves observations tell me that they are very small and impossible to be observed in future cosmological observations. So the reason why I cancel many of these operators is because not only gravitational waves must propagate at the speed of light around an FRW universe, but also they have to propagate at the speed of light also taking into account perturbations. And if you check these, we'll also put constraints on these additional operators. And also it will force this operator to have the same coefficient as this operator. So there is a long story behind this statement. There were some caveats that was studied by Copeland also more recently, but at the end, this is the final picture. So this is the first thing. Before moving to other observables, so let me put out a caveat that was discussed in the literature, which is important to consider, which I already mentioned, which is the fact that, of course, I'm making experiments at a scale which is not a cosmological scale, of course. So I'm using the same EFT to describe both LIGO observations and cosmology. Of course, one could say, okay, this may not be appropriate. Maybe new states will appear and the theory at LIGO is not the same as the cosmological theory we want to use for cosmological observations. In particular, one could say that regarding the speed of gravitational waves, something like what happens in a material for light may happen. That is to say that even if the speed of gravitational waves is different from unity on at low frequencies, it goes back to unity at high frequency. Okay. So this, of course, could happen, but notice that there are two caveats. So first of all, the observation is so precise that I need new physics to enter at extremely low scales, because at least naively, you approach the speed of light with omega squared. And since it is very precise, the measurement, you need to try to go back to the Lorentz invariant dispersion relation with very early. So you need some new physics to enter very large scales. Of course, if you do this, it's not clear at all how to reconcile these theories with local tests of gravity. It's already difficult to reconcile these theories with a cutoff of order 1,000 kilometers. Usually one can think about the Weinstein mechanism to help to improve this. But with new physics at this case, it seems very difficult to have consistency with the local test of gravity. Okay, but this, anyway, it's a caveat that is important to stress. And if you want, this gives some motivation to look at observation of gravitational waves of lower frequencies, because of course this caveat will be less severe. For example, looking at LISA, at PTAs, and in general to larger black holes. So let me skip this. Of course, what I said can be recasted in the usual covariant theory. Of course, I get the same constraints. Okay. So let me skip this unless there are questions. And then let me also mention this, but without entering into details. So one question you can ask, since I set to almost zero some of the operators in my effective theory, one typical question could be whether this situation is relatively stable. In other words, going back to my action, since I know that this operator is very small, well, you may say, okay, but maybe it's not relatively stable to imagine that this operator is very small while this operator remains large, okay? So usually there will be some renormalization that one operator will induce the presence of the others. Well, to make a quite long story short, it turns out that this relative stability can be checked, can be controlled. And I leave this to possible questions. So the logic is that these theories are protected by an approximate Galilean symmetry. And if you work out the details, the coefficients are stable, or better, the relative correction are small and much smaller than this 10 to minus 15, which is the experimental constraint I'm talking about. So I skip this, but it's an important point. Okay. Let me now come to other possible signatures of dark energy. So another thing that can happen in material is that the graviton gamma can decay into dark energy fluctuations. So usually in a Lorentz invariant theory, we don't discuss the decay of a massless particle. The reason is that the decay of a massless particle can only occur into massless particle in the collinear direction. This is actually not really a decay, it's more like a redefinition of the asymptotic states. Or said in another way, of course, a photon cannot decay in vacuum because there is no Lorentz invariant quantity associated to a photon. So there is no distinction between one low energy photon and a very high energy one. Okay, so there is nothing that I can write to describe its decay. But this is completely different once you are inside a material. For instance, inside a material, phonons, which are the Goldstone boson, which describe excitations of the material, are massless particles which decay into other phonons. So this is completely possible. And the same happens in our models. So if you take a gravitational wave, it can decay into two dark energy fluctuations. And also this decay is possible, although in the theories I'm going to describe, it's subleaving, so I'm not going to describe it. So for instance, let me take this operator in my effective theory. I write this operator because it's the operator which is not constrained by the measurement of the speed of gravitational waves. So after some work, which amounts to solving the constraints and fixing the gauge and so on and so forth, I can read this coupling in my action. And the coupling has this form, is gamma ij double dot, time derivatives, di pi dj pi. So it's a vertex of this kind. And it's pretty straightforward to calculate the decay width, the perturbative decay width of the graviton. Is given by this formula, where this scale, which suppress this higher dimension operator, is related to lambda 3 by alpha h. So alpha h is this dimensionless parameter, the one that I was discussing before. So the typical modification of gravity induced by this operator. Of course, we don't observe a sizable decay of gravitational waves, because otherwise LIGO and Virgo will not see a signal. So one can put a loose bound that this decay must be much lower than the Hubble distance, more or less, or a bit less. And this puts a constraint, which is quite strong, again, on this operator. Okay. And again, this is not the same. It's nothing to do with the speed of gravitational waves. Indeed, this operator induces a speed of gravitational waves which is equal to one, but it has to do with the decay of gravitons into dark energy fluctuations. Notice that this decay is quenched in the limit in which the speed of pi's is close to one. Again, the speed of graviton is set to one because of experimental constraints, but the speed of dark energy fluctuations is not constrained to be equal to unity. This decay is suppressed in this limit because, you can see it from the coupling. In the limit in which CS is equal to one, the decay must be forward. But since gamma ij is transverse, this coupling goes to zero in the limit in which this derivative is in the same direction as the propagation. So this explains why this decay is suppressed when CS gets close to unity. Notice that as we know, decay is not cannot be separated from dispersion. Okay, so in the previous talk there was a discussion about bounds on the dispersion of gravitational waves. So now that we know that there is a decay, of course, if I close this loop, I will induce some dispersion of gravitational waves. So this object is gamma ij double dot. So I can calculate this effect. And what I get is a dispersion relation with a correction which is k to the eight. And again, the absence of dispersion tells me that, again, there is a bound on the same operator, and this bound is of the same order as the one I already discussed. So decay or dispersion given by this operator gives a similar constraint from LIGO. Okay? With the only difference that this is also valid when the speed of I don't know if it is an interesting case, but even in principle, if the speed of dark energy is larger than unity. Let me also mention that this also implies, as you expect, that it does not make too much sense to talk about Hordensky, so to focus only on operators that give rise to second order equation of motion, because this is not stable under loops. So if you take this one of these theories and you do loops, you generate higher dimensional operators, which do not have a second order equation of motion and which induce potentially observable effects. Okay, let me skip these. and talk about very briefly about another effect, which basically is the same effect, the decay of gravitational waves into dark energy, but now taking into account that we're not talking about a single graviton, but we're talking about a very large occupation number. So we're talking about gravitational waves, that is to say, a very coherent state of gravitons. So in order to study these, we basically, so we expect that this effect will make the decay even larger, okay? And so I can study for various operators. For instance, I can study for this operator in the effective theory. And so you remember that there is a coupling, which is pi, pi, gamma. In the equations of motion for pi, I get something like this. Now, what is the physics? The physics is that I have a large gravitational wave, and this reminds a bit what happens, for instance, in preheating after inflation. There is a large in terms of occupation number field, which is oscillating. And if you are coupled to this field, of course, you're going to undergo resonance. Okay? The physics is slightly different because the inflaton oscillations are homogeneous in space. Here, the gravitational wave propagate. But with some clever choice of variables, one is able to cast also this problem into a Mathieu equation, so the equation that describes parametric resonance. So I skip most of the details, but you understand the idea. The idea is to study the resonant growth of pi perturbations induced by the presence of a large gravitational wave background. And after I do this, so I study this Mathieu equation, I can look at the back reaction. It is to say the pi's are produced, and since they have a stress energy tensor, they will induce a gravitational wave, or better, they will deform the original gravitational wave because some energy goes into pi, which changes the gravitational wave itself. So it's a nice calculation in the sense that, so it's a nice calculation because one can do everything analytically until a certain point. Well, actually, in some limit, everything can be done analytically using a saddle point approximation. But the bottom line is that one gets a formula that tells me how the gravitational wave is changed by this effect in the narrow resonance regime when basically beta, this parameter beta that I'm described the coupling is small. Now, there are some caveats, which is the following, that this parametric amplification of pi is true until I can neglect the self-interactions of pi. So when I start generating a large quantity of pi's, since these pi's have self-interaction, their self-interaction may destroy the resonance. And at this point, you have to treat the problem numerically, and we didn't do it. Okay, so this is a problem for the M3 operator, the operator that I was describing. So for reason that it's a bit long to explain, it's not an issue for the operator M4 tilde, the one that I was describing for the perturbative decay, because self-interactions are smaller in this case. So at the end, we can put the constraints also using this parametric amplification of pi perturbations. So it's a bit of a busy plot, but let me just show you the one on the left, focusing on LIGO Virgo. So this is for LISA. So this is the parameter that describes the modification of gravity. So in this regime, I go out of narrow resonance. Here, the modification is too small to be seen. And I have also to neglect this because in this region, the self-interaction of pi are too large and I cannot treat the problem without numerical simulations, but I still can neglect, I can still rule out a chunk of parameter space. Notice that On the horizontal axis, I have the distance from the source, okay? And this is important because, of course, I also have to be careful about the Weinstein mechanism, which can change the properties of dark energy. So I should be sufficiently far away from the source to be able to neglect the Weinstein screening. Okay, in the last couple of minutes, let me just mention another effect, the last one, which is basically the regime in which beta becomes larger than unity. Okay, so I go back to this equation, the one that I was studying. You see that when beta contains the gravitational wave, and in particular the gravitational wave amplitude, when the gravitational wave is large enough, not only gravitational waves can decay into dark energy fluctuations, but even pi fluctuations may become unstable. You see that when this has the wrong sign, it oscillates, but in the moment when it has the wrong sign, you can have a gradient instability of the pi's. So if this is a general thing. So in general, if you have a nonlinear theory, I'm not talking about ghosts. I'm just talking about the equations of motion are a second order, but it's not obvious that once I find a nonlinear solution, it's not clear that perturbations around these solutions are stable. In general, they may have instabilities. So if I look at the perturbations around the solution, this matrix may not be healthy, so may feature instabilities. So in general, if I focus on the cubic Galilean, the stability of the system was proven long ago, but only in the limit in which I neglect gravitational waves, and I also go into the non-relativistic limit. So this was proven exactly that there cannot be instabilities. So what we did is to generalize this analysis, including gravitational waves, and it turns out, to make a long story short, that indeed instabilities are ubiquitous and they exist. So when these instabilities will be triggered, so this is my last slide. So let me guide you through this plot. So I look at various binary systems with different chirp masses. For instance, this is a typical LIGO event, while these are massive black holes in the center of the galaxies. And as the system evolves towards coalescence, I go to higher and higher frequencies until I reach the coalescence, basically. So now, this plot shows is fixed at a given distance from the binary, either 1 megaparsec or 10 megaparsec. And what this plot shows, depending on the values of the alpha b parameter that I'm using, it tells you that the instability will be triggered at the distance of 10 or 100 megaparsec, sorry, 1 or 10 megaparsecs, as the system approaches the coalescence. Now, why I chose this 1 or 10 megaparsec? Well, again, because I want to get rid of possible Weinstein effects. So with 10 megaparsec, we should be sufficiently far from the galaxy or from the source to be able to neglect the Weinstein mechanism. And also, let me now consider a sphere of 10 megaparsec. I can count the number of events that are able to trigger this instability. And there are some uncertainties, as we know, but one can check that even focusing on massive black holes, one has more than one event per Hubble time in spheres of 1 or 10 megaparsecs. So the conclusion is that in general, this instability will be triggered for interesting values of the alpha B parameter everywhere in the universe. Because there will always be some massive black holes which is able to trigger the instability beyond the Weinstein radius where it is located. Okay, and notice to conclude is that this statement has to do with very large black holes which are with frequencies which are much lower than the one at LIGO. And so the caveat about using a different effective theory becomes a bit less severe, because now we're talking about very, very large distances. So in conclusion, let me skip these unless there are questions. So I discussed a few possible signatures of the propagation of dark energy inside a dark energy system, focusing on some particular class of models. So within this particular class of models, the constraints are very severe, and they seem to rule out most of the parameter space. Of course, there are caveats, but I think it's an interesting set of constraints that we should explore further. And I stop here. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the interesting presentation. So questions, Alexander, please go ahead.
Hi, Paolo. Great to see you. And thanks for very, very nice talk. I have actually kind of two questions. One is a bit crazy, and another one is more reasonable. So the crazy one is the following. So if graviton can decay into phonon, if we have some material, basically some medium, why would not that same happen for plasmons? In the sense, we have early universe plasma, it can be described by effective imperfect energy momentum tensor, then propagating graviton in this medium would be able probably to decay into two plasmons.
Yeah. Well, I think this in principle is possible. The point is that in the case of normal fluids, this is very, very suppressed, because it's suppressed by the Planck scale. And so in other words, the fluids that we are describing when we want to modify gravity on cosmological scales are fluids which are, in some sense, they are coupled to gravity more than usual fluids. So in other words, in a normal fluid, I would expect some coupling, which is 1 over m Planck squared, and a numerator, some scale that has to do with the physics of the fluid. So this is very small for normal fluids. So I think that it's kinematically allowed, but very small. While in these cases, if you want to go in the regime in which gravity is modified, you are forced to push this parameter to be very large.
Okay, thanks. And the second question, which is more technical, is the following. So I remember we probably even discussed it already, that in the case of this, your last slide, when beta is large and when this Galileans would, this cubic guys would decay. Mm-hmm. My point is the following, that the sound speed is equal to some constant, and it's isotropic only around cosmology. So if you have a strong gravitational wave background, then basically the sound speed should be anisotropic. Mm-hmm. And especially so if it seems that your sound speed in one direction becomes just negative, then probably it's worth taking into account the corrections to the speed of propagation for this stuff.
Yeah, but I'm not sure why this should save the day. So what you're saying is that in general, when I look at solutions and I look at perturbations around it, this matrix in general will not be isotropic.
Yes.
It will have some this is completely true. And the point is that generically, you will have some direction in which you have either or even both. You can have either ghost instabilities or great instabilities. And this is what we are saying. So we can. Now, let me also mention this, since I didn't have much time. Of course, the fate of this instability is not within the effective theory. So I'm not 100% sure that the fact that this instability develops may not be a catastrophe. It may only say that I cannot use the effective theory to describe these processes. But the fact that the instability arises, I think it's pretty ubiquitous.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Ciao. Ciao.
Okay, Takahira, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the nice talk. And I want to ask about the resonant decay of graviton.
Mm-hmm.
And so I couldn't get the global picture of this decay process. And so what kind of momentum does the decay product have? And also how is the dispersion relation of this particle pi?
Yes, good. This pi has a linear dispersion relation just parametrized by CS, okay? So this is the CS that appears here in this formula. Notice that the graviton, we assume and experimentally, it is luminal, but the pi may be subluminal. So what happens is that the pis that are produced perturbatively, they have an energy comparable to gamma, unless CS is very small. So in general, we're talking about the decay into two particles with a certain angle, which depends on CS, with frequencies which are similar to the one of the original graviton.
Yeah. So you talked about the resonant process.
Yeah.
So that is also a similar thing?
Yes, it's similar. Actually, if you want. One can say that this description is not very accurate because we don't have a single graviton, but we have a very large occupation number of gravitons. Again, it's very similar to the picture when you study the end of inflation. Instead of, as in first approximation, you start looking at the perturbative decay, but then you realize that actually, usually it is not a very nice description because you have a huge occupation number. This is quite similar. The only difference, of course, is that as I said, we're talking about something which the background is not only time dependent, like the inflaton condensate, but also space dependence. But it turns out that we can recast basically up to some change of variables. We can recast the equations in the same form, the Mathieu equations that are used to describe the inflaton decay. So it's a very similar process. So it's the enhancement, if you want. You can see it as the Bose enhancement of the fact that it's not one graviton decaying, but it's a condensate of gravitons decaying into pi's.
Okay. Other questions? So I have a naive question. Could you summarize which models are the best ones? I don't know, quintessence, KGB maybe, or something else.
Well, okay, I think one has to be, let me say something going to the conclusion, okay? So models which are completely unconstrained from all what I said are these, which are basically, these are K-essence models, plus non minimal coupling, if you want. So these are completely unconstrained. Of course, one can also consider, I didn't mention about DOST, but you know that DOST can be obtained by a conformal transformation which depends on X. So there are also a class of models that I didn't discuss which can be obtained from these, and they are still not constrained by these observations. Also, so these are completely unconstrained. Now, also, again, I want to stress that in making these bounds, I'm making some assumptions. So, for instance, the fact that I'm using the same effective theory to describe LIGO and cosmology. So I'm making some assumption. Now, in some cases, it could be that, you know, as I said, the instability is there. It tells me that this theory breaks down, but once you have UV completion, maybe these constraints may be reinterpreted. So I just want to say, the ones which are safe are the ones as I said, but also be careful that these constraints, they have hypotheses, and one has to be careful about which hypotheses enter in each constraint.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Somebody else? Well, if there are no more questions, let me thank the speakers.